Let's continue our study that we've been doing for the last couple of weeks. Study titled, Finding Hope to Get Past the Darkness of Death. Finding hope to get past the darkness of death. Now, you realize that I didn't say finding hope to get over the darkness of death. I said to get past the darkness of death. Because you don't ever get over losing someone you love. You get past it and there's a new normal. We've already learned that from time to time, grief can raise its head up at any given moment. Death is real. We live in a land of death. And death is real because of the sin nature of man. So God took care of that by allowing His one and only Son to die on the cross of Calvary to deal with our sin nature so that we can live forevermore. Death is real. Today at 4 o'clock, I had a funeral in Ocala. While we were sitting here just a few minutes ago, I got a text from a friend that her daddy had just died. Mr. Ellis Connell. So let's remember that family in our prayers. Mr. Ellis is about 100 years old. So the Lord blessed him with a lot of years on this side. But while we were sitting here, just that quick, death has already invaded the ranks of another family. So death is real, and it's something that we have to deal with many times, day by day. I've been pastoring churches for over 30 years. And in my 30 years, I cannot tell you how many funerals that I preach, but I preach many. And I use the term I preach, but most of us preach our own funeral. I've been able to speak at many, okay? But death is real, and it's something that you and I have to deal with every day. I remember a time back in the 80s in this town, right here in Adel, Georgia, that I had three funerals in one day. Three in one day. I had a 10 o'clock funeral, and Mr. Pete Boone was the funeral director at that time. Had a 10 o'clock funeral, a 2 o'clock funeral, and a 4 o'clock funeral with Pete Boone. Three in one day. That's hard to imagine. But death is real. If you will, turn your Bibles to Isaiah chapter number 53. Isaiah chapter number 53. And I want us to look at verse 3. Notice what the scripture says. He is despised and rejected of men. Who is this talking about? Jesus. The prophet preached this 700 years before Jesus was ever born. He is despised and rejected of men. And listen to what it says. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Let's pray together. Father, we're so grateful and thankful again that we can come and study just a little bit about a subject that we really need to learn more about, because it's a subject that we deal with every day of our lives. God, I pray that you'll use this to help not only me, but to help others who deal with the grief process every day. God, help us to use some of what we'll learn to cope better and to realize that you truly are acquainted with grief and you understand it. And because you understand it, it's your greatest desire to give us comfort. And Lord, we pray that you'll do that now in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the greatest things that you and I have been blessed with is the opportunity to know that we have a Savior, and His name is Jesus Christ. And because Jesus died, you and I no longer have to die. As I've shared with you already, I know that we live in a land of death. And I know that if we live long enough, these old bodies housed our spirits will one day die. Jesus tells us it's coming. One day we all will leave this world by the doors of death. But listen, Jesus died so that we no longer have to die. I made the statement last week that one day you'll probably read my obituary, but don't believe a word of it, because I'll be more alive that day than I am now. In fact, I'll have restored knees. I won't have the knee ache anymore. I was talking to a good preacher friend of mine who didn't have any hair, Dennis. He said when he got to heaven, he was going to have a head full of long, blonde hair, and the wind was just going to blow in that hair. And I don't know that. I don't know exactly what it's going to be like, but I know one thing, we'll be like Jesus. Amen? I do know that. Jesus said, "He that lives and believes in me never dies." So if we believe in Him and if we've trusted Him as Lord and Savior, we pass from what we know as death to everlasting life. And when we leave these old bodies that we live in now, we move into a spiritual world. Our spirit leaves this body, and the very moment that we close our eyes in death, we draw our last breath of earthly air, we breathe our first breath of heavenly air. And it's not polluted. I want you to know that. When Jesus rose from the dead, you need to understand that death at that particular time was defeated. Now, until Jesus returns, we still experience death. But one day, life will not give away to death. Children will not have to mourn their parents anymore. Parents will not mourn their children anymore. There will be no more widows or widowers grieving for one another. Yes, death is an enemy, and it is the last enemy, but one day death itself will die. Now, this present reign of Christ guarantees us that one day death itself will die. As you weep, remember this one who weeps with you. Jesus understands you, and He understands what you're going through. Any of you who are dealing with grief as I speak, Jesus understands what you're going through. He stood at the grave of one of His best friends, and the Bible says Jesus wept. He wept. He grieved for His friend. Now, I have a different twist on that scripture myself. Most people say He grieved for His friend. All the people who saw Jesus weeping there at the tomb of Lazarus, they said, "Oh, look how He loved him." I always thought maybe He was probably weeping because knew that He was going to bring him back to this old sinful world. And He was already in a better world, all right? I mean, that's just a thought. I mean, the Bible doesn't really say that, but I mean, good gracious, if I'm already in the portals of glory, don't call me back here. I want to be in the presence of God. But the Bible said that He's a man of sorrows. So He knows your heartache, acquainted with grief, our text says. But listen, He does more than understand. You need to understand that God will always act in your behalf. Now, God will never act unless you allow Him to act. You ever prayed a prayer and you wondered if God was going to act? Well, I got news for you. If you'll let him, he will. He'll act on your behalf. But the problem with most of us is we don't ever take the time to pray a prayer to ask God to help us. Anytime you're going through any type of sorrow or grief, he is the great comforter. In fact, the Bible teaches us that he is the only one who can comfort you in your time of need. Listen, not only does he understand what you're going through, but if you'll let him, he'll also act. Jesus will not let death reign forever. Now, on the cross, we know that he defeated death, and his resurrection is a guarantee for you and I that we too will defeat death, but our defeating death will be in him. And we'll be resurrected to a new life of peace with him. One day, I don't know when, but one day, the Lord Jesus Christ is going to come away, or come, and the physical death is going to be done away with. He's going to usher in the new heaven, the new earth. In that new heaven and new earth, there'll be no weeping, there'll be no dying, there'll be no sickness, there'll be no need for hospitals, there'll be no need for doctors. And one day, I think it was right here in this church, Pete Boone was sitting in the back, I was preaching revival. And I said, one day, bless God, there won't be no undertakers in heaven. Pete said, I'm planning to go. I said, but you won't be an undertaker there. Amen. Won't be a funeral director in heaven. And as I say that this evening, Pete Boone, one of my best friends in heaven, he's there. I believe that with all my heart. Now, what you need to do, let me share with you some things that you need to do as you go through this grief process. Grieving leaves you emotionally, mentally confused. We've already gathered that. It's painful, and it's painful in expected ways, but it's also painful in unexpected ways. Death interrupts your plans and messes up your schedule. Now, sometimes death brings people together, and sometimes death drives people apart. Did you hear that? Sometimes it brings people together who's been apart. And sometimes it causes people who at one time was together to grow farther apart. It's sad, but that's the way that it happened. Death mixes the best and the worst of memories. Because death is confusing and a mix of emotions and experiences, it's often hard to know exactly what to do when death walks into your door. I want to give you several biblical methods, several biblical directions for you to go in whenever this happens to you. Many of you are here and it's already happened in your, you've already walked down this road. But here's just a few ideas. Number one, be honest about your emotions. Be honest about your emotions. Listen to me. Being a Christian does not mean being stoic, walking around like a zombie. God doesn't want you to hide your emotions and wear a happy face mask. You can't do that when you have suffered such a tremendous loss. God wants you to come to him with complete honesty. With complete honesty. You see, in the Psalms, God invites us to bring our honest grief to him. If you look at Psalm 34, verse 15, it depicts God as a loving father watching over his children and listening to their cries. I've always been a mama boy. Now, I love my daddy. My daddy left this world early in life. And I didn't have the pleasure of enjoying my daddy like I did my mother. And so I was always mama's boy. And I remember when mom and dad bought me my first bicycle. That thing had training wheels. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Training wheels. And so I learned how to ride that bicycle with training wheels. Daddy looked at me one day and he says, "Boy, it's time now to take the training wheels off. You've been riding that thing for several weeks with the training wheels." And so he took me to the State Farmers Market in Tifton, Georgia. And my granddaddy worked there at that particular time, and we went over there, and Daddy took the training wheels off, and he said, "Now, I'm going to get you started and turn you loose." And he said, "All you got to do is pedal and keep going." And I did. But he didn't tell me what to do to stop. And whenever I tried to stop, I lost my balance. And I tore all of the hide off his left knee when I come down on that concrete sidewalk. And the first thing I did was say, "Mama!" And my mother, who was sitting under one of the sheds there at the market watching me, jumped up and ran and picked me up and dusted off my knee and kissed all the hurt away. You see, that's what parents do for their children. Now, Daddy picked me up, but he wouldn't kiss my knee. But Mama did. She kissed the hurt away. Well, see, that depicts the type of father that we have in Almighty God. He is a loving Heavenly Father, and He wants to hear your cries. I shared with you the story about the young lady who was about to lose a 34, 5, 6-year-old husband, and how that she just kind of really got all over her young pastor. And the young pastor, not knowing how to deal with that, left me standing there with her, and I thought she was going to whoop me. And after she got through saying all of those things that she wanted to say to me, this was her last words. "And what do you think about that?" I said, "Have you let God know how you feel?" God wants to hear it. I didn't need to hear it, but God wanted to hear from her. In Psalm 13, Psalm 22, Psalm 42, and again in Psalm 73, it pictures God's people running to Him in grief and confusion. Don't hide your emotions. When you're struggling, run to the one who knows you completely and loves you faithfully. Peter says it this way in 1 Peter 5:7. "Casting all your care upon Him, for He careth for you." Let God know how you feel. God wants to know. And listen, God understands you're crying. It's okay to cry. You know, sometimes when we cry, it helps us to kind of refocus and to move forward. And to kind of unload that burden of grief and allow the Holy Spirit to come in as we share our emotions with God. And when we do that, It helps us get past the darkness of death. Number two, run to where comfort can be found. Run to where comfort can be found. Now, we've already talked about how people are. And people mean well whenever they say things like, "Oh, I'm so sorry," or "I know how you feel." I learned real quickly not to say those type things. Sometimes you just don't have to say anything. Just being present is all that's needed. Just being there. Whenever you know that you're having to deal with overwhelming grief, run to where you can get some help. Run to where comfort can be found. When he was suffering, the Apostle Paul said an amazing thing about the Lord. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3, he said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies." Listen, the God of all comfort. Man, whenever I see somebody dealing with grief and going through a hard time, I want to reach into them and fix them. I want to try to do my best to help them, but I don't possess the power to do that. The only thing that I have that I can offer is presence. Just being there to represent the holy presence of the one who can help. All real and lasting comfort has its source in the Lord, because he is the Father of compassion and comfort. Now, think about this. Your Heavenly Father is in charge of comfort and compassion. He exercises his loving power on earth so that comfort will be available. Have you ever watched somebody who didn't really have a relationship with God going through what we call the grief process? And you find yourself saying, not to them necessarily, but to yourself, "How in the world does anybody go through anything like this without God? How in the world can anybody go through something like this without God?" Listen, whenever anyone, anytime, anywhere experiences real comfort, it's because of God. Because he is the source of all comfort. And only God can make comfort happen. These people that make you think that they can fix your grief problem, don't you believe a word of it. Because God is the only one, the only one who can give you comfort. He has power to bring hope. He has power to rest your soul in ways that you will never, ever understand or conceive. God in his grace has assigned this job to himself. Now, I'm going to go ahead and say this, and I probably shouldn't, but I'm going to say it anyway. Too many people trying to play God and do what only God can do. Only God can comfort a grieving soul. Number three, don't fall into grief's traps. Don't fall into grief's traps. You see, moments of sorrow are also moments of temptation. You have an enemy who wants to use this moment to tempt you to question God's goodness and love. You know how I know that? Because I fell right into that trap. God, let me remind you of who I am. God, let me remind you of what I have accomplished for your kingdom. God, let me remind you like he didn't know. You ever been there? Been so angry and upset with God that you tried to remind him of who you were in life like he didn't already know you? You see, I was looking back at yesterday's victories and all the things that had happened in my life, and then all of a sudden, everything that had happened in my life was just destroyed overnight. Boom, just exploded. You don't think that grief hit me? You have an enemy who wants to use your moment of grief to tempt you to question God's goodness and God's love. He will tempt you to be envious of others and become angry. And that anger, in return, if you don't deal with it, listen, will turn into bitterness. And bitterness, when it has finished, will eat away at you like a cancer eats away at a body. The struggle of grief is not just a struggle of sorrow, but it's a struggle of temptation as well. Always look out for grief's traps. Watch yourself for signs of doubt. You see, when you're your weakest, it's then that the enemy can come in and cause you to doubt. If there was really a God, he wouldn't have let this happen to me. Anybody ever said that before? Anybody want to be honest about that? I think we all have. If we really search our hearts, and when doubt comes, usually anger follows, and then envy. I sat with a lady one time who had been very, very, very strong in her church, and her husband, who was a deacon in the church, very active in the church, just died totally unexpected. His faith became sight overnight. And for several months, I didn't see her in church. Tried to make contact by way of phone. Went and knocked on the door several times. No one would come to the door. And one day, I found her in a grocery store. And I stopped, called her by her name, and I said, "My goodness, we have missed you so much in church. You're such a vital part of our congregation." And I guess just those few words that I said caused her to revisit her grief. Be careful what you say, people, to people who are grieving, because just sometimes a few little words can cause them to revisit their grief. And when she finally regained her composure, she said, "Brother Danny, I can't come back to church." And I said, "Why in the world can't you come back to church?" She said, "Because I'm envious of every woman that still has a husband that she's able to sit with in the church service, because I don't have mine no more." You see, if we're not careful, doubt will turn into anger. Anger will then turn into envy. And then envy, if you're not careful, will turn into self-pity. And then self-pity will turn into bitterness. And when bitterness has conceived, you're just bitter with God and everybody else. When you see these things going on in yourself, there's one thing that you need to do. You don't need to run to your preacher and confess to your preacher. You don't need to run to anybody but Jesus, because He's the only one that can help you deal with it. Run to Jesus just as fast as you can for His forgiveness, for His strength, and for His protection. Tonight you're looking at your pastor. I'm living proof that He is a forgiving God, that He is a strengthening God, and that He is a God of protection. Amen. Because let me tell you something. I doubted. I got angry. I envied. I filled with self-pity. And I filled myself with bitterness. One day, I ran to Jesus. Because you see, my pastor, he was still alive at that time. He couldn't help me. All he could do was love me. Had friends who had similar experiences. But they couldn't help me because they hadn't had my experience. There came a time that I ran to Jesus just as fast as I could. You see, when it all started, I ran as far away from Jesus as I could run. Whenever I had gotten so far away, I turned back and double-timed my soldier brother back to Jesus as fast as I could get there. And He stood there with His open arms saying, "Come unto Me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. I'll give you peace. I'll give you comfort. I'll help you." And He did. Now, I'm going to surprise you. Do you know the whole time that all of that was going on in my life, I was still standing behind the sacred desk of God trying to preach every Sunday? The only thing I can say to that is God used me in spite of myself. God is able. And God will help you. But you've got to run to God. You've got to run to God. And don't be ashamed to run to God. Because He's always waiting with open arms. I wish we had finished tonight, but we're going to stop right there. And we'll have another session next week, I guess. I said last week this would probably be our last session, but we didn't get through. Next week we'll pick up where we've left off. I've given you three things. We'll review those three real quickly, and then we'll go on to number four. And maybe we'll be able to finish next week. This is a subject that you could teach for months and never get past it. You just scratch the surface. You may be here this evening, and you may be dealing with some things that only you and God know about. Do business with Him, because He's the only one that understands what you're going through. Stand with me, if you will. Thank You so much, Lord, for being such an understanding God, to help us get past the darkness of death, to help us cope and to deal with things that we face every day. God, you're the great physician. Help us look to you to help us as only you can. In Jesus' name, amen.